Good morning, dear colleagues and my dear students. This is Vikram Reddy, working as school assistant arts at ZPSS Kusmanchi from Khammam district. From the last few classes, we are discussing about the different elements of atmosphere. We discussed about the structure of the atmosphere, and we discussed important elements like about pressure and winds. In the today's class, we shall discuss another important element of atmosphere, that is humidity, and also about the precipitation. So this, we shall discuss about humidity and precipitation. So before getting into the topic, if you know, answer the question, what is humidity? So you might learn in the previous classes, particularly in 6th and 7th classes, and that you know the very well about the humidity. Simple, the answer is the amount of water vapor present in the air is called humidity. So this we already discussed in the first lesson itself, first class itself, that the atmospheric air consists of different gases with different percentages. But along with those gases, the atmosphere composed of gases and also water vapor. It is around 0.4% of atmosphere. It consists of water vapor. So the amount of water vapor which consists in the air is called as humidity. So as we know, the moisture means the water vapor in the atmosphere is derived from the water bodies, means from the oceans and seas and other important water bodies, particularly during the summers and during the times where the temperatures will be more, the water or the air will gets heat up. Generally, the water will also gets heats up, and the water will turns into water vapor, and it will reaches the atmosphere. The water vapor will reaches the atmosphere. So the whole process is called as evaporation. The evaporation means the water which lies in different water bodies turn into water vapor is called as evaporation. And the humidity consists in the air also, it gets evaporation, means it gets humidity or water vapor through the evaporation, and also with transpiration process will take place on plants. If you observe the plants in the early morning time, you can observe water droplets on the leaves of plants. Means the water content in the plants will be evaporated during nights particularly, and the water vapor will turns into water vapor will reaches the air. The process is called as transpiration. So through the process of evaporation and transpiration, the water will turns into water vapor. Here, this is the hygrometer. It is the instrument to use to measure the amount of water vapor that lies in the air. Next, some examples how we can assume about the percentage of humidity or percentage of water vapor in the air. If the temperature and water vapor are high, we feel sweating. As we know, means if the air consists of maximum amount of water vapor, it cannot receive more and more water vapor. So automatically, the sweat on our body, it cannot be received by the air. So we feel more and more sweaty, particularly during summers. That was due to the high amount of water vapor in the air. As we know, water vapor is a very important component in the atmosphere. The water vapor changes over a time. It changes with the times, means on the basis of temperatures or on the basis of pressure also. In high humidity, our sweat doesn't cool. I told the example, particularly during the summers, the air can hold maximum water vapor. After reaching 100%, it holds maximum amount of water vapor. It cannot get more water vapor. So the sweat on the bodies doesn't get cool. When low humidity, in the situations of low humidity, the air requires more and more water vapor. It receives more and more water vapor from our body also. That's why we feel more thirsty during low humidity days. So these are the one or two examples to understand the impacts of humidity. Basically, we use the term humidity to calculate the amount of water vapor in the air. But the exact term or the concept used to measure this is relative humidity. What is meant by relative humidity? Actually, it is a ratio. Means the maximum water vapor that the air can hold at a given temperature and pressure, the actual amount of water vapor it holds at any given time. Simple, we can define the relative humidity is the ratio between the maximum amount of water vapor can hold by air at a particular temperature and the actual amount of water vapor it holds. The ratio is called as relative humidity. I will show you through an example. See, this is air of 1 cubic meter. Assume it as the 1 cubic meter of air. At the point 20 degrees centigrade temperature, the air can hold maximum 80 grams of humidity. You assume in a particular 1 cubic meter of air can hold 80 grams of water vapor, means humidity. But at this particular temperature, 20 degrees centigrade, the air holded 40 grams of water vapor or moisture. Means the maximum capacity is 80 grams, but at that particular given time or at the given temperatures, the air holded the 40 grams of water vapor. So out of the 80 grams, the 40 grams is considered as 50%. So the relative humidity is 50%. Means this is the ratio between the maximum amount of water vapor it can hold and the actual water vapor it holded. So the difference or the ratio between the maximum amount and the actual amount of water vapor. So that is called as relative humidity. In this particular case, the relative humidity is 50%. Generally, relative humidity increases when the temperatures decrease or water vapor increases. If the water vapor increases in the last cases, if the water vapor increases to 60 grams, means automatically the relative humidity will become 75%. Means whenever the water vapor percentage in a specific temperatures increases, automatically it leads to the increase in relative humidity. For example, if the amount of water vapor decreases to 20 grams, automatically the relative humidity will become 25%. Means if the content of water vapor increases, that leads to the increase in relative humidity. If the water vapor decreases in a specific time and a specific temperature, the relative humidity will also decrease. That is the difference or the relation between the relative humidity and the water vapor. Next, if the atmosphere has 100% of relative humidity, means if the 1 cubic meter of air, for example, if it holds maximum amount, it, as we know, as we discussed, that it can hold 80 grams of water vapor. So in a particular temperature, if it hold 80 grams of water vapor, that is called as 100% relative humidity. When atmosphere reaches 100% relative humidity, that is called as saturation level. Means after that, the air cannot receive more water vapor because it reaches to the saturation level. The temperature at which the saturation level is reached, the temperature is called as dew point. Means at dew point, the atmosphere reaches the 100% relative humidity at certain temperatures. So after that, it cannot hold water vapor in the air because already the air consists of maximum amount of water vapor. Next one is condensation. We discussed about evaporation. The next process is condensation. Condensation is nothing but it is opposite to the evaporation. In the evaporation, water turned into water vapor. Means it from liquid stage to it turned into gaseous stage. In the condensation, the water vapor, means which is in the gaseous stage, will again turn into liquid stage water. So evaporation, condensation process is simply opposite to evaporation. It involves conversion of water vapor into water droplets or ice crystals. If generally when the temperatures are high, evaporation process will take place. When the temperatures are cool in the higher altitudes, the condensation will take place. Means the water vapor will turn into water droplets. If the temperature is low, at the low temperatures, the water, even the water droplets again turn into ice crystals if the temperatures are very low. So means condensation, in the process of condensation, the water vapor will turn into either water droplets or ice crystal, means a solid status. So if the relative humidity is more than 100%, means if the air holded maximum amount of water vapor, the amount of water vapor that present in the atmosphere gets condensed. Condensed means turn into water droplets. The condensation can take place only when minute solid particles are present in the atmosphere. In the first class itself, we discussed that the atmosphere will consist of, along with the gases and water vapor, it consists of solid particles also. These solid particles will help to observe the sunrise and sunset in orange color, and also they helps in the process of condensation and precipitation. The condensation not only takes place in atmosphere, but it will take place on the contact surfaces also. For example, if you take a glass, if you fill up the glass with cool water, almost all heavy cool water, you can observe water droplets outside the glass also. So why? What is the process in this? Why water droplets formed on the outer part of the glass? Generally, when the inside the temperature is less, means the glass consists of cool water, then the moisture in the air surrounding the glass, outside the glass, will automatically, which is very near to the glass, it comes contacts with the cold surface. So with this cold surface, the air automatically, it will condenses. That's why we can observe if you pour some cool water or cool drinks in glass, so outside the glass also we can observe some water molecules or water droplets. That was due to the turning of at moisture or water vapor turn into water droplets. That was due to the cool temperatures in the surrounding areas of the glass. So this we can observe means the condensation will take place not only in the air or atmosphere, it will take place on the contact surface also. So that is the one concept. So if you observe the water cycle, this is called as the water cycle. In this water cycle, in the process, the first water bodies at the higher temperatures, the water in the water bodies will be evaporated, means the water will turn into water vapor and they mix up with the air. The evaporated water vapor will reaches the atmosphere in the form of water vapor. So while the air moves upwards, the temperatures will be less. We discussed about normal lapse rate. So at the lower temperatures, at the higher altitudes, the water vapor will turn into water droplets and they forms into clouds. So the process is called as condensation. Means if the water turn into water vapor, it is called as evaporation. If the water vapor turn into water droplets, it is called as condensation. Next, if the water droplets reaches the earth surface, it is called as precipitation. Precipitation means reaching of water droplets from the air to earth is called as precipitation. Again, due to this precipitation, it leads to the filling up of water with the different water bodies like oceans and the seas and the rivers. Again, in the summer, the evaporation takes place. So this is a cycle. It continues in that process. So this is called as water cycle. So we discussed about evaporation and condensation. So the next another important we shall discuss about precipitation. So before that, the dust particles in the atmosphere also attract water molecules from the water vapor. We already discussed that. This causes condensation. Billions of water droplets together form clouds. We discussed water vapor which mixed up with the air through the evaporation process at the higher altitudes. The water vapor through the process of condensation, the water vapor turn into millions of water droplets. The millions of water droplets together form into clouds. If the temperatures are very less, even the droplets will turn into ice crystals. This also we discussed. So clouds will form. So on the basis of their height, at which height they form, clouds are of different types. The clouds which formed at higher level, they are called cirrus clouds. At middle altitudes, if the clouds forms, they are called cumulus clouds. If the clouds form at the lower stage of lower altitudes of troposphere, the clouds are called as stratus. And again, in the lower part of the troposphere, if the clouds forms, they are called as nimbus clouds, which are causing for the rain. So if the clouds, after forming of clouds, the water droplets will reach the earth's surface, it is called as precipitation. When the droplets, water droplets get heavy, if the temperatures are go on increasing, the water droplets, millions and millions of water droplets will forms into clouds. Whenever they feel heavy, the clouds will burst and their water droplets reaches the earth surface. It is called as precipitation. Precipitation is a Latin word. Actually, the term precipitation, it is derived from a word called as precipitatio. That means fall headlong, means continuous pouring of water reaching to the earth surface. So from that we received the term precipitation. Precipitation means reaching of water to the earth surface. It takes place in different forms. One is rain. Next one is snow, hail, fog. These are the different forms of precipitation. As we know, general form of precipitation is rainfall. It is the common form of precipitation. If the temperatures are below freezing point, means that is below 0 degrees, the water vapor condenses into ice crystals, means water turns into solid status, ice crystals. And if they falls on earth, if they consist of little crystals, it reaches the earth surface in the form of snow. It is called as snowfall. If the temperature decreases more and more, when rain falls through a cold layer of air, the raindrops get frozen into ice, and that is called as sleet. Means nothing but hailstones. Sometimes the condensation take place at high altitudes at lower temperatures. As we know, while we are going upwards at the higher altitudes, temperatures will be very less, even less than the freezing point, means even less than the 0 degrees. At that particular point of time, the water vapor turns into water, and the water droplets again turns into ice crystals. But after when the water turns into ice crystals, the clouds cannot hold the ice crystals because they are heavy. It tries to reach the earth surface, but the clouds cannot, in the form of rain or in the form of snow, it cannot reach the earth surface due to ascending wind currents. While wind currents, while they are reaching towards higher altitudes, these clouds cannot burst out. So the ice crystals existed in the clouds. They grow and become more, reaches the large size, and they fall down as solid masses, means ice cubes. This form of precipitation is called hailstones. In Telugu, we say them as vadagandlu. So these hailstones causes damage to crops and buildings. So on the basis of their origin, rainfall is classified into the different type, particularly basically three types. First one is convectional rainfall. This is basic rainfall. Second one is orographic rainfall. Third one is cyclonic rainfall. So in this class we shall discuss one by one, but in the today's class we shall discuss how the convectional rainfall will form. See, this is the basic form of rainfall. When surface of the earth becomes warmer, then the surrounding air get heated. For example, if you take the water body on the earth surface, at higher temperatures, the water part will also gets heat up. The water will gets heat, and the water changes through a process called as the evaporation. The water turns into water vapor, and it reaches the air, because the air at higher temperatures, it is light and reaches the higher altitudes. As we know, as air reaches the higher altitudes, it consists of lower temperatures. So at the lower temperatures, the air consists of water vapor, will turns into again condensation takes place, water vapor turn into water droplets. The millions of water droplets will form clouds. At certain temperatures, the clouds cannot hold the heavy weight of water droplets, and the clouds burst in the form of rain, and the water reaches the earth surface. The water droplets through moving from different areas, it reaches the water. So this precipitation is called as a convectional rainfall. Means, as we know, evaporation takes place in the water bodies. The water, due to high temperatures, the water turns into water vapor. The water vapor is lighter in weight. Lightweight water vapor reaches the higher altitudes. At the higher altitudes, temperatures will be less. At that less temperatures, condensation process will take place. and the water vapor will turns into water droplets, and the millions of water droplets will forms into clouds. When at a situation where the clouds cannot hold more weight, the clouds will burst in the form of rain. This process of rain is called as convectional rainfall. Generally, convectional rainfall is common near tropics, because in between the tropics, the temperatures will be more, the low pressure belts will form near water bodies. The when it will they get heats up, the water will turns into water vapor. So that's why convectional rainfall is common near tropics. And even in the summer, in interior parts of the continents, in the interior parts of the continents, in summer generally the temperatures will more, so automatically they lead to give convectional rainfall. Generally, after the hottest part of the day, the rain occurs in the form of short heavy showers. Particularly, we can observe in India in the summers, due to the high temperatures throughout the daytime, the rain occurs in the evenings in the form of sudden and short showers. Sometimes the rains are accompanied by thunders and lightning. Particularly, we can observe in the months of May. Even we can observe in the form of hailstones, which can damage the houses, crops, and the other infrastructure. So this is about the convectional rainfall. In the next class, we discussed about the we shall discuss about orographic and cyclonic rainfall. But today, what we learnt, so we shall recapitulate once again. We shall discuss about the term humidity. What is meant by humidity? Next one is what is relative humidity? What is the difference between humidity and relative humidity? Humidity is basic the amount of water vapor which consists in the air is called as humidity. But the relative humidity is the ratio between the maximum amount of water vapor the air can hold at particular temperature and the actual amount of water vapor it holded. That is, the difference is called as relative humidity. I will describe condensation. Turning of water vapor into water droplets is called as condensation. And you can also describe evaporation. Turning of water into water vapor is called as evaporation. What are the types of clouds? Different types of clouds we discussed on the basis of height, cumulus or nimbus. What is precipitation? The water which is in clouds reaching earth in different forms is called as precipitation. What are the different forms of precipitation? Rainfall, snow, fog, hailstones is called as different forms of precipitation. Different types of rainfall: convectional rainfall, orographic rainfall, and cyclonic rainfall. Explain convectional rainfall. So we discussed just now. You try to go through the textbook once, read the whole lesson that we discussed today, and try to answer the questions. So with this, I will conclude today's lesson, thanking you all for giving this opportunity.